For his entire career, this researcher has labored to solve a mind-boggling math problem called the geometric Langlands conjecture.
This particular thing happens to be very, very tasty. You just start salivating. You want to go and solve it.
The geometric Langlands conjecture is an important component of a vast effort to develop what's been called a grand unified theory of mathematics. And now, after three decades of work, Dennis Gaitsgory, along with his former grad student Sam Raskin and seven others, have produced a monumental 800-page proof of the conjecture.
It took a long time to figure out what the right edifice to build and what materials are available. They've built a whole world.
For Gaitsgory, the epic pursuit began in 1994 when he first heard about the geometric Langlands program as a graduate student.
I guess I understood about 15%, if that, but I was kind of completely awestruck with the way mathematical objects that you know about, the way they combine and lead to these conjectures. There's something extremely appealing about it in Langlands program, especially in geometric Langlands.
What is now known as the Langlands program began in 1967, when the mathematician Robert Langlands wrote a letter to the French number theorist André Weil, describing a plan to connect far-reaching branches of math.
It's a lot of, you know, parts of number theory, parts of physics, and it has kind of different compartments and different kind of corners that are operated in parallel.
The Langlands program takes its inspiration from another part of mathematics, Fourier analysis, which splits complex signals into simpler components.
The Fourier transform is one of these kind of basic building blocks of much of math that we simplify. We try to think of everything in terms of these basic patterns.
Consider the complex sounds of the world around us. Comprising each of these very different sounds is a fundamental collection, the pure tones. Each tone is a single frequency. Mathematically, the pure tones are sine waves. These simple oscillations are the building blocks of all complex sound waves, from radiostatic to symphonies. In 1822, the mathematician Joseph Fourier showed that any wave can be broken down into an infinite sum of sine waves, using a technique now called the Fourier transform. The Fourier transform is like a recipe generator. You input a complicated wave, and you get back its ingredients, the amplitude and frequency of each component sine wave. Fourier analysis is an essential part of modern technology. Its applications range from JPEG compression and image recognition to quantum physics and MRIs. It has also opened a revolutionary new framework in pure mathematics.
Our experience with Fourier theory guides many of the ways that we think about the Langlands program and the way the subjects develops and the sort of phenomena that we're seeing.
Fourier theory has two components, basic building blocks and labels. Imagine a child's toy castle. This castle can be disassembled into individual building blocks. And these building blocks can then be sorted by color into bins and labeled. Similarly, the Fourier transform disassembles a complex wave into individual sine waves. These are like the building blocks. Each sine wave can be labeled with its frequency, or how quickly it oscillates per second. The labels on the bins are more than just a way to organize things. They can be used to rebuild the original complex wave, and as an efficient shorthand for communicating information. For example, when you send a voice message, your phone doesn't transmit an entire complex sound wave. Instead, it breaks it down and sends just the labels, or frequencies of the component sine waves. The receiver's phone then reverses this process, converting the labels back into the contents of the bins to reconstruct the message's original sound wave. To open up new connections between other distant mathematical worlds, Langlands researchers look for analogies of Fourier theory in other contexts. Within the vast world of mathematical objects, spheres, functions, prime numbers, are there other basic building blocks that can fit into the bins? And if so, what are the labels? In 1994, the mathematician Andrew Wiles proved the famous Fermat's Last Theorem by developing just one small corner of the Langlands program. This demonstrated the power and possibility of Langlands' vision. When Langlands began his search for analogs of Fourier theory, he first looked for labels in number theory, a branch of mathematics that studies arithmetic.
And what Langlands predicted is that the labels in this game are certain objects of deep arithmetic interest.
In the original number theory formulation of the Langlands program, the building blocks are functions. But functions can be replaced by a complex abstraction called sheaves, so named because mathematicians visualize them like sheaves of wheat, growing on top of other mathematical objects.
Initially, each sheaf itself was a way of labeling, here's a kind of function I like, continuous functions, differentiable functions, special class of functions. But then something kind of strange happened over the decades. People started thinking about the collection of all these collections.
Building on the connections between functions and sheaves, mathematicians shifted many parts of the Langlands program to a new geometric setting. In the geometric Langlands program, a special subset of sheaves called eigensheaves are the building blocks in the bins, akin to sine waves. The labels on the bins are something called representations of the fundamental group, descriptions of the loops that can be drawn on spheres, donuts, and other shapes. Similarly to how the Fourier transform breaks down complicated waves and labels them by their frequencies, the geometric Langlands program breaks down sheaves into eigensheaves, each with a label. Mathematicians can study these labels and translate that new information back to eigensheaves, and then sheaves themselves. In the mid-2000s, amid a flurry of interest in the geometric Langlands program by both physicists and mathematicians, Gaitsgory finally began to see a way forward.
Until that moment, it was, in some sense, like walking in the dark in the woods. From that moment on, I saw the framework.
Gaitsgory drew what he called the fundamental diagram, a particular way of establishing the correspondence between sheaves and their labels. But his diagram was missing one piece. He needed to know that every single eigensheaf is contained within a special composite sheaf known as the Poincaré sheaf. Raskin also became hooked on the problem.
Sam became a grad student a year exactly after this revelation in 2006.
After finishing his PhD, Raskin continued to study the Poincaré sheaf. A Poincaré sheaf is like white light. Just as white light contains every color, mathematicians expected the Poincaré sheaf to contain every eigensheaf.
Even though it's hard to write down an individual eigensheaf, it turns out that you can write down very directly what happens when you amalgamate all of them.
If Raskin could prove that the composite Poincaré sheaf contained all eigensheaves, then he could use this as a tool to access the individual eigensheaves, like a prism splitting white light into a rainbow. In 2022, Raskin and his own graduate student finally proved this, completing Gaitsgory's fundamental diagram.
They cracked this mystery, and after which, basically, the shape of the solution became clearer.
Over the course of the next 2 years, Gaitsgory and Raskin led a team that wrote 5 papers that proved the geometric Langlands conjecture.
There is a set of questions that have so much symmetry that that symmetry completely determines the solution, and this is kind of, I would say, the deepest, the richest kind of statement of that kind that's been established.
Of course, mathematics is infinite. Once you solve these, some new paradigms appear.